a lighthouse looking out to see the Isle of Old Cape Ann, searching for the sailors coming homeward to the land. Old Cape Ann, by the shore and by the lea, from the woodlands to the water, just a heartbeat from the sea.
This brief video is my sailing resume. It is being put together such that anyone considering me for crew or charter will have some idea of my abilities. The picture here of me was taken in 1979 aboard Tangaroa. I now look more like the next picture. My name is Robert Schuldenfrei. In 2005, I fully retired from a career in the computer industry. If we had moved to the west coast of Florida instead of Palm Beach, I may well have bought another sailboat. But the waters off my home are not the most exciting place to cruise and sail. I am looking for some opportunities to get out on the water by acting as crew for some boat owner anywhere in the Tri-County area of Miami-Dade, Broward, or Palm Beach. I have been sailing all of my life on boats owned by my father, myself, a sailing club, and various tour boats. When I was 8 years old, my father bought a 1919 Sparkman & Stevens designed 39-foot yawl. This was the fall of 1951, as Dad liked to buy his boats in the fall before the owner had the expense of a winter storage. For summers between 1952 and 1956, I learned the sailor's arts aboard Touria. While I could describe the details of sailing, I think it would be useful to tell what sailing means to me by way of a brief word picture. It is Labor Day weekend, one of the years between 1952 and 1956. The skies are clear and the wind is from the northwest. These are very favorable conditions on Raritan Bay. The club is running a rendezvous to Atlantic Highlands at the mouth of the bay just inside Sandy Hook, New Jersey. All the larger cruising boats will be there Saturday night for an overnight adventure. We leave the mooring about 10 a.m., and due to the wind strength and direction, we are down there shortly after lunch. There is no need to put into the anchorage yet, so we continue to sail out into the Atlantic Ocean, just south of Long Island. Dad lets me take the helm for hours on end. Even when he appears to be asleep, he seems to know if my young mind wanders and I get off course. Even with his eyes closed, he is aware of the sun's position and can tell if the kid is minding the store. It is a trick I will use years later with my own children. One of the things Dad and I share is a love of actually sailing the ship. There are times when none of the passengers want to take the tiller, but that presents no problem, as I will hold the helm for as long as it is necessary. The feel of a ship underway with sails properly set is to be at one with the universe. By the way, the kid in the picture is your humble author. Running a ship the size of Touria required some help. When it was just mother and dad, they needed at least one other hand to raise and lower sail. Touria had a gaff rig mainsail. This meant that it took two people to raise sail. With dad at the helm, the minimal manning was three, with four being a more standard crew. This required a little planning before your weekend voyage was a done deal. The task fell to mother to impress the crew for the weekend. One of the things that might be ideal for me today is to be that extra pair of hands. While Dad bought another boat in late 1950s, my parents bought a Blue Jay for my younger brother. While Steve did enjoy sailing his boat, more times than not, it was me who was at the helm and was learning to race one designs. In this picture, I am sailing Sassy, and the crewman in this shot and the next one is not even the boat's owner. In addition to racing this craft, I attended a summer camp that had a fleet of Lapstreak 14-foot sailboats. I took these boats out at every opportunity I got. While I do and did enjoy one design racing, my love of sailing extends to anything that moves by the power of the wind. As you will see below, I have sailed everything from a windsurfer to a 95-foot Essex-built fishing schooner. If the opportunity came up, I would be game for getting back into racing once again. In early 1960, Dad bought a Triton, the first mass-produced fiberglass sailboat. At the time, this was the hottest boat around. Over my objections, he named the boat Second Wind. I thought the name was too cute for a sailboat, but would have to wait until I owned a boat of my own to use my own name. For the years I went to college, weekend summers were spent aboard this craft. It was well equipped for racing with a large Genoa and a beautiful blue and red spinnaker. While we entered only a few races, we always did well and even won one race I can remember. Of all the boats I have ever handled, the Carl Olberg designed Triton was the best sailing for feel in my humble opinion. Its tiller gave you just enough weather helm to get a sense of the boat, but not so much that it tired you out. Unlike a wheel, the craft was sensitive to the smallest helm correction. Under sail, you could feel rather than think sailing. And now we come to my boat, Tangaroa. As I was suggesting above, this was the name I wanted my father to use for the Triton. For over 15 years, I held the thought that when I bought a boat, that would be her name. The name was Polynesian in origin, Tangaroa being their Neptune. She was a Bristol 26, a fin keel, spade rudder craft. This picture was taken by a friend soon after I bought her. I was living in Wickford, Rhode Island at the time, and my house was 200 yards away from the boat. Like Dad, I bought Tangaroa in the fall of 1975. I sailed this wonderful companion for each season through the fall of 1981. In 1978, I moved to the Boston metropolitan area, and Tangaroa was moored in Boston Harbor. From the picture, you can see some of the go-faster gear I added such that she could pass any unmodified Bristol 26 and a fair number of boats much larger than she. The mainsheet traveler was one of the best additions I made. The tiller extension allowed me to hike out to windward. This did two things. First, it added a little weight to reduce heel a tad. But second, it allowed me to easily see the set of my jib and the telltales that had been taped to the luff of the Genoa. Another reason Tangaroa was fast was that she lacked an auxiliary engine. Many Bristols had the redoubtable Atomic 4 inboard, but I had a 10-horsepower Mercury outboard. When under sail, which was most of the time, I could cant the engine so that the prop was out of the water. What a difference that made. One small note on this view of Tangaroa is the small flag flying from the starboard spreader. That's my owner's flag. It is the only part of my ship I retain to this day. I am truly blessed in that my good wife, Pat, also enjoys sailing. Here is a view of her while we are underway on Cape Cod Bay. You can just see the skyline of Boston under the boom. We took a number of overnight sails in this area before our daughter Rachel was born. I started my company in the fall of 1981, and I had less time for carefree sailing. Additionally, the yard work in the spring, fitting out the boat, became a time trap I just could not spare. With a heavy heart, I put Tangaroa up for sale after the work had been done in the spring of 1982. But I could not give up sailing. For many seasons, from 1982 until 2000, we joined the Boston Sailing Center and sailed their fleet of Ericsson 25s and J24s. The last sailboat I sailed regularly was the tour boat on Gloucester Harbor, the Thomas E. Lannan. I made a deal with the owner, Tom Ellis, to buy a season pass such that I would ship out any time I wanted to sail this 95-foot honey of a 1905 Essex schooner. So if you have need for a crew member or know someone who does, keep me in mind. You can reach me at 561-582-3340 or by email at bob@s-i-inc.com. There is no sailboat too big or too small that I would pass up. May you always be sailing on a broad reach.
Town on the Salt Marsh River, they built many boats before. Hardy classic schooners, Gaff Rig, Maine, and Ford. Names like Tebow, Columbia, Fredonia, ready to sail and call. And many a dragger, old square rigger, and knockabout catch and yawl. But there hasn't been a big schooner down the ways of 50 years of true. Until Tom Ellis came.
we'll show them what we can do.
Every woman and child and man in this town knows the sooner landing. Built by hand in 97 with a whole lot of work and a little help from heaven.